Welcome back. I am Vivian Kamsime, and with me is Mr. Willis Bashasha, the director of the NRM Manifesto Implementation at that party, the National Resistance Movement. And we are talking about the NRM Manifesto, which is being celebrated this week, and this week is NRM Manifesto week. So we are talking how much of this manifesto has been implemented, and what is the progress of the promises that were made to Ugandans in the 2021 general elections, because they promised us a number of things here and there, and we want to know, are they delivering? Have they been able to do steady progress? Because that's the word they use very often. I have a problem with that word, steady progress, because you have been in power for quite some time, and steady progress, honestly, by now should mean that you have achieved a number of things, and there's real progress, not steady progress. Let's get to the issue of security. This has been NRM's major achievement for years, because they've had a disciplined army, and the men in uniform have been very disciplined. In fact, on different occasions, the president has come out to clearly state that he has a very disciplined professional army that is able to protect and serve Ugandans, that is for the police, and also the army, which is able to come in different situations. In fact, we serve in different parts of Africa on peace missions because of how strong, professional, and what we are able to deliver as a country in that line. But we are seeing people being gunned down. And a few years ago, in the years of state attorney who was shot down, John Kagezi, that time, we would have to wait for police to tell us, give us reports from investigations about who was the killer. You will remember the time of police officer Muhammad Chirumira, who was gunned down. We didn't know who was gunning down Ugandans. But as I speak right now, we know who is gunning down Ugandans. And the security of the nation, as we speak right now, is in question, because if someone is armed and you happen to have an argument with them, or there is a bit of bad blood here and there, then you should be scared for your life. Please tell us, do you get concerned or moved about the fact that you could be moving backwards in terms of security?
First of all, it is true that security is the bedrock of the development. And it has also been one of our key fundamentals as far as governance and democracy is concerned. And I can say without contradiction that the territorial integrity of Uganda now is secure. We don't have any war in this part of the country. And what we are experiencing, or what we used to experience at one point in time, were what you'd call these urban crimes, isolated cases of crime, criminal nature, like in the very same cases you are raising. Of course, we had those cases where because of these forces, ADF coming into the country and then do their operations, and we have some members of the Ugandan public suffering from this kind of issues. But the government has also been able to contain the ADF incursions, especially through the West. And some of the characters who have even been within the country have also been netted, and you know their chief person is even in Ruzira. So these incidents you are quoting now, of saying the people are gunning down are known, I would say they are just isolated incidents whereby, for whatever reason, these individuals decide to abuse the powers that or the authority that they are entrusted with, especially if you are a person in uniform and you have a gun. Instead of using it to protect the life and property of the citizens, you are now turning it against them. So it's I think it is also throwing a new evaluation on probably the management of these kind of arrangements, say the guard system and the rest of it. That's why the president was saying, for example, on behalf of the UPDF, he cannot believe that a person who was meant to guard can end up turning against the person he was supposed to guard and gun him down. It was shocking.
You see, when you call them isolated incidents,
yeah,
then it is, I think, a bit disturbing, because this is a pattern. We are seeing a pattern.
I wouldn't even want to say it's a pattern. I think it's just coincidental that maybe something has happened here and happened here, but it shouldn't be treated to mean that it's as if the security has lost its grip on
no,
there.
The other day, former traffic police spokesperson had her home actually broken into by robbers or gunmen who broke in and actually killed her guard by hammering him on the head. And I think those are kind of patterns, because as we speak right now, some police officers have been netted, have been arrested over the matter. That is traffic spokesperson.
That also tells you that
Farida Nampim.
It doesn't matter who is who. The point is that he was a Ugandan citizen who faced those
a murder in her home.
Yes. So the fact that the police has already moved on those criminals and arrested them should be sending a message that the government has not lost grip on the aspect of protecting its citizens. You see, as society grows, so is crime, and probably the sophistication it is crime is also executed, and every other incident that happens is also a learning opportunity for whatever. Even these programs we are talking about, when we are implementing them, they also come with their own challenge. And we learn and we get to know that probably the design was not right. Maybe we left a gap here, which gives opportunity for some people to play around, that kind of stuff. Sometimes it's very hard to have a foolproof kind of situation prevailing all the time. So these kind of challenges may be for a long time. The security could, even within the way the security management in itself, because of being so disciplined and whatever, certain things could have been taken for granted. Maybe it's high time and they evaluated certain procedures, certain processes, due diligence on the type of recruits that are being brought into the security forces. So these are issues that need to be looked at and addressed. So there are certain things probably over time that could have been taken for granted, and therefore need to be we need to go back to the drawing table and say maybe in this area we could have overlooked this, and maybe it is the one which is leading to this kind of stuff. But large and by, the country's security situation is under control, and I think there is no need to worry. These incidents, yes, they are there, they can cause a scare, but I don't think they should be meant to mean that the security situation in the country is in a crisis. Not absolutely.
The NRM promised to ensure democracy, rule of law, and equal opportunities. We still have people disappearing and tortured, and many are your political opponents. Would NRM be considered a good leader? I'm talking about the political space.
Oh yes, the political space is open. We have had elections here. And
but the opposition cannot have rallies without being arrested.
No, you
without.
See, we also need to look at some of these things in context.
Yes.
You know, these rights or freedoms must also go with responsibility. And some of these things must not be done with an impunity. So, like you said, there is a law, there are procedures. So it's important that all of us as citizens tend to look at this for purposes of living in harmony. There could be government excesses here and there in trying to manage those situations. But it's also important that the other players respect the other, you know, as you exercise your rights and fundamentals, also be considerate of the other citizens. We are witnessing where certain political processions were ending, leading to people losing their businesses, properties in the name of, you know, political processions. So, you know, there is need for order, and the government is the custodian of order. So, in one way or the other, I don't subscribe to this business of what you are talking about, the disappearances and the tortures. Torture is outlawed here, and I think people who have been involved in torture, the president has been very categorical, must answer in person. If you are involved in torture and it is proved, you must answer in person.
Can you confidently tell us that the opposition can hold a rally as we speak right now without them being intercepted by the police or having arrests of those who are participating? Can you confidently
I believe so.
Say that?
I believe so, especially if they have gone through the right procedures that are required for them to hold their rallies. I'm not in police. I'm not a police officer to give that confidence. But what I know is that from the laws that govern this country, if they follow the procedure, they should be able to enjoy what
you
you're
see
asking.
Within your party again, you have there's the MK movement that has been having rallies around the country, and they have been successfully holding those rallies. Have they been going through those procedures?
Can I request that you don't take me there? Now you are just taking me political, and I don't want to go into politics. But I cannot say that there is, at the moment, there is one president in this country, and so the rest must be sorted out by the Constitution.
Well, that's a very interesting take, because your youth in the NRM party have been taken up by this movement. Aren't you worried about the youth?
I don't know how you are measuring that.
Composition of the youth in your party, because they are now part of the other.
That's what I'm saying. I don't know what measure you are using to get to that conclusion, because you see them at the events and shouting.
Yes, we see them participating in those events, but also pledging their allegiance to the head of this movement. And clearly, they have called your party. In fact, let me just be precise. They have called it reactionary. Mm-hmm. And so they have moved to a movement.
Maybe you will call people from the party secretariat to come and deal with those answers. Not me.
Okay. The cost of living in the country is high, and yet in your manifesto you promise to improve the economic conditions in this country. Why has the NRM failed to reduce the cost of living?
Sometimes the cost of living is caused by many factors. Some could be within our control, others could be beyond the control of government. If you have been following properly, the macroeconomic direction of the country has been very, very clear. We have been able to manage inflation. It has been a single digit for many years. The interest rate, the CBR, has been single digit for some time. Of course, we can say Uganda also is part of the global economy. Some changes somewhere could bring about certain changes here, which may be inevitable. For example, changes in the world oil prices may come here and affect us, and which may raise the fuel price. Not that we want it that way, and now the economy is dictated by the.
But there are interventions you could make. You could do subsidies, on certain items like fuel.
You see.
And that would actually bring down the cost of living.
Yes, but those solutions, are they sustainable? Uganda at the moment is a liberal economy, is a liberalized economy.
Yes.
The forces of the market forces are supply and demand. The prices are determined by forces of supply and demand. So now those interventions you are proposing, at one time I remember there was a point where people were up in arms to say government should cap CBI, the rates at Bank of Uganda, and the government said, no, we can't do this. This is not sustainable. And I think Kenya did, but it is regulating why it did it, and it's running away from it. And I think over time, as the economy stabilized, we have been able to move on. Like I said, now fuel, because the world prices have gone down. Even here, I think fuel has quite gone down. We still had, we've been lucky because the food production is on. The seasons have been good, so we have been able to contain the head whatever inflation. So sometimes it is about the prudent way of looking at things. So it's not about the excitement of saying, oh, for the sake of this, let's move in with subsidies, let's do this. What happens the next day? Where will those subsidies come from to support this when the revenue base is slowly is not performing well? You know, so you have to be able to what I would call smart thinking and smart action. And I think the government has been very steadfast in that direction.
Okay, finally, as we close the show, the NRM Manifesto Week is still young. Mm. What should Ugandans expect from you in this week?
Very, very good. Now, the question, that is a very, very good question. My appeal to Ugandans.
On what grounds is it good?
My appeal to Ugandans is that this is the time for the government to come to you as citizens and say, this is how far we have gone on this social contract. This is very good because when we get out of elections, sometimes these are areas which have been going below, and there is nobody to come and explain. Either it's only the president who is always burdened to explain these things, and Ugandans are not updated. Then you find even along the way, because people don't know that some of those things that are being done in their respective areas of living are done by government, they can be claimed by individuals. But also as part of governance best practices, I think it is also in order for government to be proactive, to come out and be able to talk to its citizens, engage them, and say, you know, this is ABC, this is how far we are. And the beauty of this also, what we found out is that we have been also able to, you know, to update you, the media, on some facts, especially how far things have been gone. A lot has been done, but I think as government we have not been very, very emphatic on communication. We have not been having effective communication. And then when you don't do that and you leave the space to other people, they will come and say what they want to say on your behalf, and then they may put it in another form, and that's when we start stampeding around, and that's what you call reactionary. But this time we are proactive. We have come out and say, this is this. What we have not been able to deliver, it's for this reason. And these are the way forward on probably how we intend to deliver on the same things we promised. So to me, this week is a very, very important week in the governance processes of this country.
Do you think President Museveni will be on the ballot come 2026?
Well, that's the decision of the party.
Yeah. Okay, what's your opinion?
My opinion is that I have no problem with that if he's still interested.
Well, that has been Mr. Willis Bashasha, the director of the NRM Manifesto Implementation. Until next week, The Checkpoint. Thank you for watching us.
Thank you very much.